Hello, 3D printing friends. Today on the BV3D channel, we'll learn how to edit and compile the Gyres UI Marlin firmware. Stick around and we'll get into it right after this. I'm Brian, and you are watching BV3D. Hi, welcome back. Hey, if you're new here and you're wanting to learn about 3D printing, 3D modeling, and other 3D printing related stuff, start now by subscribing and clicking the bell so you don't miss anything. Okay, so today we're going to edit and compile the Gyres UI Marlin firmware for the Ender 3 V2. After I released the video about installing the Gyres UI Marlin firmware, some of you asked if it would work on an Ender 3 V2 printer that you had installed an Ender extender on. The Ender extender products for the V2 can increase the bed size up to a massive 400 by 400 millimeters and the Z height up to a towering 500 millimeters. There are several kits which fit the V2 and you can check them out at enderextender.com. And the short answer is yes, you can use the Gyres UI Marlin firmware with the Ender extender kits, but the pre-built binary firmware files are all for the stock hardware. So in order to do this, you'll need to edit the source code and compile it. Plus, there are other reasons you might want to edit and compile Gyres UI for yourself, even with a stock or mostly stock printer. Maybe you want to be able to address the full 235 by 235 millimeter area of the bed, or you want a 4x4 mesh leveling grid instead of the 3x3 or 5x5 ones in the pre-built binaries. There are probably as many reasons as there are people with 3D printers. So in this video, I'll show you how to change the X, Y, and Z maximum values and compile the firmware with those changes. Now, I thought this was going to be hard to do. I've compiled Marlin before, but that was the Marlin 1 series for the 8-bit boards, and it used the Arduino IDE to do the compilation. Plus, it's been a long time since I did that, and I knew things had changed, and I knew the tool chain was different, and that meant I'd have to track down the necessary software to make this work. Well, I'm happy to report that editing and compiling the Gyres UI Marlin firmware is actually pretty easy. In fact, it was a lot easier than I thought it was going to be. Well, let's get all the necessary software bits together and then we can get started. First, we're going to need Visual Studio Code, a free code editor from Microsoft. You can get it from code.visualstudio.com. Now, by the way, there are links to everything down in the description. Once you have VS Code downloaded, install it. Now, I'm making an assumption here that you know how to install software on your computer. For VS Code on the Mac, that means unzipping the file and dragging it to the Applications folder. On Windows, that means doing the thing that Windows makes you do. Same on Linux. So VS Code is just a code editor. On its own, it's not a development environment, but it is extensible. To be able to compile the Gyres UI Marlin source code, we'll need to install an extension in VS Code to handle that task. And that extension is Platform.io. Installing that is easy. First, launch VS Code. Then, click the extensions icon on the left side of the window. It looks like a stack of blocks. In the search field, type Platform.io, and in a few seconds, a list of extensions appears. At the top of the list is Platform.io IDE. So click the install button for Platform.io IDE. A few seconds later, it's installed and its cute little ant-like face appears on the left side of the window. You can give it a click if you want. And maybe after that, click open in the PIO home list. Of course, we're going to need something for Platform.io to open, and that something is the Gyres UI Marlin source code. So we'll need to go download that. Head over to github.com/gyres and click on the Marlin repository. In there, click the green code button and then click download zip. Locate the downloaded file. It's named marlin-ender3v2gyresui.zip and unzip it. This will result in a folder named marlin-ender3v2gyresui. Move this folder to your documents folder. Then open the Marlin Ender 3 V2 Gyres UI folder. If you watched my video about installing Gyres UI, you may remember that there are several different precompiled firmware files that you can pick from to download and install. These range from just the basic default Gyres UI Marlin firmware to versions with BL Touch bed probe support, to manual mesh leveling support, to universal bed leveling support. Well, inside this folder, there is a configuration files folder. Guess what's inside? That's right, configuration files. The ones we're interested in are the ones inside the E3V2 templates folder. For the purposes of this video, in which we're going to make changes to the X, Y, and Z axis maximum values, I'm going to use the default-noprobe configuration files. But if you're wanting to compile support for a BLTouch or a manual mesh leveling, you'll use one of these other sets of configuration files. Each of these template folders contains two configuration files, configuration.h and configuration_advanced.h. Whichever template file you want to use, open its folder, select the two files within, and copy them. Then open the Marlin folder and paste the files, replacing the two existing configuration files. Okay, let's check our progress. At this point, we've got VS Code installed. We've got the Platform I/O extension installed in VS Code. We've got the Gyres UI Marlin source code downloaded. And we've got the configuration files from the default-noprobe template parked inside the Marlin folder. Well, now that everything is in place, let's get back to Platform I/O. Here, from the Platform I/O home screen, click the Open Project button. Navigate to your Documents folder and open the Marlin Ender 3v2 Gyres UI folder. The first time you open this, you may be asked to trust the authors of the files in this folder. I chose the Yes, I Trust the Authors option. When the folder opens, Platform I/O automatically selects and shows the platformio.ini file. And that's not the file that we need to edit, though, so click the Marlin folder here to expand it. Now, with the project opened in Platform I/O, here are the two configuration files. And while both of the files from the template folder needed to be copied and pasted into place, all of the changes that we're making today happen exclusively in the configuration.h file. Click the configuration.h file to show its contents. So let's put ourselves in the position of a person who has installed an Ender Extender kit and now has a 300 by 300 millimeter bed and a 400 millimeter Z-axis. We are editing the source code because we want to change the bed size as well as the Z-axis maximum value. So it's kind of a pain to go scrolling through the file trying to find where the X bed size, Y bed size, and the Z-axis maximum position are defined. It's much easier to simply search for these things. So let's do that. Click the Edit menu, then click Find. A little search bar appears over here. Search for X_bed_size. That will take you to the line in the code where it's defined. So I'm going to change the value to 300 to match the physical distance the Ender Extended Ender 3v2 can move along the X-axis. Conveniently, the Y_bed_size value is right here as well, so I'm going to change that to 300. And just a few lines down from that, there's the Z_max_position value. I'll change that to 400. Keep in mind, you can set these to whatever you want. If you're watching this video and you have a stock Ender 3v2, maybe you want to be able to address the entire 235 by 235 millimeter area of the bed. In that case, you'd set the X and Y bed sizes to 235. Just remember that if you set them outside the bounds of how far the printer can actually move, you're going to have a bad time. Or at the very least, your printer is going to have a bad time. Oh, and as long as we're in here editing things, you can change the name of the printer too. Search for custom_machine_name, and you'll see that it's set to Ender 3v2. If I wanted that to be Brian's Ender 3v2, I could change it here, and I think I will. And that's about it for the editing. Save your changes by clicking the File menu and selecting Save. The next step in this process is actually building or compiling the firmware with the changes that we've made. Do that by clicking the checkmark icon down here at the bottom of the window. Platform I/O will begin compiling the source code and building the binary file that will load onto the printer. This can take a couple of minutes to complete, so be patient while it works. And there, it's done. Right here, just above the success line, Platform I/O tells us where it put the binary file. And it's here. Look in the .pio/build folder and then in the STM32F folder. The firmware file is the one that starts with firmware and ends with bin. This folder structure is all within the Marlin Ender 3v2 Gyres UI folder. On Mac and Linux machines, files and folders whose names start with a period are considered hidden files. I don't think Windows does this, though. So for me, the easiest way to get to this folder in my operating system is to right-click on the firmware.bin file and click Reveal from the menu. That will ask the operating system to open the folder this file is in and highlight the file for me. Okay, in a previous video, I covered the steps necessary to flash the Gyres UI firmware onto an Ender 3v2, including flashing the screen's firmware to give it pretty new icons. Flashing the screen's firmware isn't required. Gyres UI will still work just fine if you don't do it. It just gives you fancy new graphics. If you'd like detailed instructions on the process, the video is linked down in the description, and it's also on this card right up here. But simply put, the process is copy the firmware.bin file onto a FAT32 formatted micro SD card, turn off the printer, insert the card into the printer, and turn on the printer. When the printer powers up, it checks for the presence of a firmware file on the card. If it sees one, it'll install that firmware. The whole process takes about 10 seconds. Now that it's done, you can see that the custom printer name is showing up right here on the home screen. And we can check that it really did increase the maximum travel distance for X, Y, and Z. First, looking on the info menu, we can see that it shows the build volume as 300 by 300 by 400 millimeters. And second, it will allow us to enter those maximum values when attempting to move an axis. Like, it'll let me request a move of the X-axis up to 300 millimeters. I'm not going to actually do that move because the printer can't physically move the X-axis that far. The stepper motors would hit the end of their range of motion and just keep on trying, and that's not good for the motors. Also, it makes a really annoying sound. So, no, not doing that. Okay, now you have the tools to edit and compile the Gyres UI Marlin firmware, and of course Marlin firmware in general. For more information about changes you can make, features you can enable, and printer behaviors you can modify, I recommend checking out the Gyres UI GitHub and the Marlin firmware websites. Links? Got you covered. Check the description. Since this video deals specifically with Gyres UI, I'll mention that the Gyres UI GitHub has a wiki tab with useful information and a discussions tab where you can ask questions about configuring Gyres UI. Of course, it's always a good idea to search there before you ask. You may find that your question has already been answered. Well, 3D printing friends, that's about all the time we have for this episode. And now that we're at the end, let's go print something cool. Hey, real quick before you go, I wanted to say thanks for being one of the super awesome people who sticks around all the way to the end, and thanks for all the likes, comments, and shares. And an especially big thanks to those who directly support what I do. You're all wonderful for doing that, and I really appreciate it. If you like this episode, a thumbs up would be great, and if you'd like to help support the channel, check the description for ways you can do exactly that. And hey, if you haven't already subscribed, please do. It's absolutely free, and it's an excellent way to help keep me making these videos for you. Well, that's it for this one. Thanks again, and I'll see you next time here on the BV3D channel.